Good afternoon, friends. And I can see that the deliberations in the last session were quite energizing because nobody is dozing off. Everybody is quite attentive. And before we start this session, just a couple of house announcements. Today, for the invitees and the foreign delegates, the dinner will be at Hotel Hyatt Regency, because we thought, you know, making each day everyone to travel late night will be very tiresome, because some of you have really traveled very, very long distances. So the dinner is hosted by the Attorney General. For Indian delegates and members of the Governing Council, since there is a meeting of the Governing Council today evening, the dinner is organized at Habitat Center itself, which will start at 7 near the Juniper Hall. So the coaches for the international delegates to Hyatt will leave within 15 minutes. The coaches will be here after the conclusion of this session. And for the BRICS legal talent participants also, the coaches will be ready in another half an hour, so that everybody is there in Hyatt on time, and the delegates can freshen up also and join for dinner by 7, 7:30. The dinner at Habitat Center will commence at 7. Thank you very much. Now I will request Mr. Amarjit Chandiok to come and moderate this session. And I will also request all of the panelists to kindly take their seats on the dais.
Good evening, everybody. I hope the tea has done its job, or coffee. We start our second part of the financial and legal cooperation in BRICS, key issues and thrust areas. And the first speaker to make his presentation before you is a professor from director of BRICS Law University, BRICS Law Institute from Russia, Dr. D.V. Vinsity. I was looking at it whether I can call him Whiskey, but I couldn't do that. Please welcome, sir.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure for me to participate in such an interesting discussion, and I'm happy that my family name can pronounce in so inspiring way in India. So my Daniil Vinitsky. And dear colleagues, we have discussed many interesting topics in the framework of our sessions, and I would like to focus in the framework of my report to the topic which is quite relevant for us, taking into account the existing deadlines which was set by the G20 and also OECD. This is the elaboration of a multilateral instrument in the area of tax law. It's really a unique period which we can see now. Maybe 70 years ago, we could see the comparable situation where GATT general tariff agreement were elaborated, and it replaced the existed bilateral trade agreements. And could you please show me how? Okay, it's excellent. So, and the main question here is, for BRICS at least, is the competitiveness of our system. Competitiveness of our system in the area of tax law. Why this question is so important at this stage of the development of tax regulation. The point is that now we have thousands of bilateral tax treaties. I can show you just pictures which very in simple way can show the statistic. For instance, first you can see Brazilian tax network of bilateral tax treaty 32. After that, Russian 81. After that, India 91. And China 99. And finally, South Africa 76. These treaties are similar. When we speak about bilateral tax treaties, and in general, you should take into account that in general we have about 4,000 tax treaties in the world. The main question, are these treaties similar? To what extent the provisions of this treaty can influence to revenues of the respective countries? To what extent they can influence to protection of taxpayers? And both these questions are quite important for us as lawyers. During the last 80 years, the main instrument which was used in order to provide the same approach to the issues were so-called model tax treaties. There were two of them. One of them, OECD model, it was proposed by a developed country, and another one, UN model, which was proposed for the relations which involve developing or less developed countries. And the peculiarity of the position of the BRICS countries is that we are in the middle in the some sense. Because in some area we can be considered as developed country, and at the same time we have some economical, social problems, and in that sense we need to protect our interest as it was also necessary for developing countries. And can we say now that the level of protection of our interest is sufficient at the level of the model tax treaties? I can make some small examples just to understand to what extent there is a diversity between our approaches. It is not necessary to read these small letters, but you can see just number of the articles. And you can see that they are different in case of all countries. So, at the moment, we have show in the framework of existing international organization in the OECD, in the UN, different approaches to the some issues. Is it really the reason of these differences? Is it connected with the difference in our economy interests in the area of in some social areas or etc.? Sometimes, at least many of experts is not sure that it is really that there is any real basis for this diversity and different approaches. I think that at this important stage, BRICS could be a real block and can elaborate the common joint position in the area of tax regulation. Why it is so necessary? Why it is so important? When we have bilateral tax treaties, sometimes it is easy to change it. Or at least, if you cannot find a success, a consensus, you can just terminate a bilateral tax treaty. The world is big, so and you can find another trade partners and etc. But when we have a multilateral treaty and the model is fixed and influenced by developed countries, it's very difficult to change the multilateral instrument. It is the same situation like in WTO, the same situation like in World Bank, and etc. So when the institute will be created, it will exist, it will be very difficult to change the rules of the game. And if we are not active in this area, we can predict that the possible result of this activity in the area of elaboration of a multilateral instrumental will be the reproduction of the existing instrument of the ECD model, taken into account by the mere fact that thousands of staff experts from the OECD, they work on these issues and they more focus on these problems and issues, and the secretariat of the OECD is the main technical boot for the elaboration of such an instrument. So I think, and our expert group, which involved many colleagues from BRICS countries, from the biggest universities of the BRICS countries, and also from practitioners, we propose to focus on some issues which could be reflected in a multilateral instrument in the global format, or at least at the level of BRICS. I don't want to go to some technicalities, but I just would like to mention some issues which were proposed by our colleagues from India, tax experts from India and Brazil. For instance, they have mentioned tax sparing credit. This is a very simple and understandable example. For instance, some developing BRICS countries would like to protect their interest and to stimulate, to make some incentives for developing some area of economy, or to stimulate some economic activity and use tax incentive for this purpose. To what extent it is effective in the current OECD system? The effect will be nearly zero. Why? Because the main instrument for the avoidance of double taxation is the crediting offset of tax which is paid in the jurisdiction of source against the tax which should be paid in jurisdiction of residence. Okay, at source you can do the taxation zero using your right and tax sovereignty. But at the same time, investor from another country couldn't offset the tax from South country when the investment come to the residence country, because you don't tax the respective investment. And if you use the instrument of tax sparing credit, it is possible to do that, because you can offset also taxes which was not actually paid, but should be paid if you not use the tax incentives which were introduced by the national government. So this is the very, maybe a little bit technical, but important instrument how to protect tax sovereignty and to give a possibility to developing, and also for BRICS countries, to stimulate their economy in such an area. It's really a great topic, and I can speak a lot about it, but the main proposal which I would like to conclude is that it's really an important period of time, and the deadline is 31 of December 2016, when we can to accumulate our proposal and to find the basis for the joint position. At the moment, 37 proposals were submitted to the Secretariat, and only two of them from the BRICS countries. I think we should be quite active, much more active than we are at the moment. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much for giving us the overview and urging that we must now pull up our socks and probably proceed with more proposals. I was only adding that in the new insolvency regime that we have brought in, as I mentioned in the last session, fortunately the government dues we have brought after the unsecured creditors. So that sovereign debt comes after workmen, then comes secured creditor, then comes the corporate or what you have, business debts, which is unsecured creditor, and then only comes the government debts of income tax and other dues, pari passu with other people who are not otherwise creditors in the first three categories. Thank you so much. May I now request Mr. Dao Tio from China, please. He is also the professor and executive director of the Institute of BRICS Legal Studies of East China University of Political Science and Law. I always thought politics and law go together, so here I find institute also going together. Please come.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a good pleasure and honor for me to attend this third BRICS Legal Forum, because I come from the East China University of Political Science and Law in Shanghai. And the second BRICS Legal Forum was held last year in my university, and today I've seen so many old friends. I'm very happy. Today, my topic is the interconnection amongst securities markets of the BRICS countries and relevant coordination on regulation. This topic is very popular in China and in other countries because we have seen a trend of the emergence, the mergers of securities exchanges in all of the world. We have seen in the past 10 years, there was a wave of mergers present in the securities trading markets in all of the countries. For example, we have seen in 2007, the New York NYSE, New York Exchange have merged with the Euronext in 2007 and built the most biggest security market of the world. And on April 2007, the Nasdaq stock market of the United States have also owned shares in securities exchange in North Europe. And the other countries, for example, the Deutsche Börse, the German stock exchange, reached also an agreement with London Stock Exchange. And the London Stock Exchange reached a merger plan with Toronto Exchange in February 2011. And the Singapore Exchange announced to purchase Australia Stock Exchange. And in 2013, the two major stock exchanges in Japan and in Osaka and Tokyo have also merged. And in 2015, the three largest stock exchanges in Pakistan also merged. And set up the biggest Pakistan stock exchange. Also in this year, a Chinese company, the Caixin Group Co. Limited, have a plan to purchase the Chicago Stock Exchange. So we can see the increasing global trend of the merger of the securities market. Second, we can see another trend, the